esta tarde en este evento titulado El cese del carbón, un paso inevitable para la lucha contra el cambio climático. Según tenemos en nuestra invitación, este evento se va a conducir en inglés, pero dado que estamos en la zona verde, quisiéramos saber de los que están aquí cuántas personas, porque todos los intervinientes hablan en español, menos uno, y queríamos valorar cuánta gente podría seguirlo en inglés antes de continuar. ¿Cuánta gente podría seguir en inglés? Okay, so then we will continue in English. Sorry for those that cannot follow it in Spanish. And okay, so this event is organized by IDMA, which stands for International Institute for Law and the Environment. I am the director of IDMA, and we have organized this event because we consider that coal must be phased out in the fight of climate change. And why is this necessary? Because in the world we have more around 2,067 gigawatts of coal installed. But what is the problem with those facilities? That they are one of the main emitters of greenhouse gases. So coal power plants are contributing enormously to the problem of global warming. And for this reason, the Secretary General of the United Nations has made a call this year, Antonio Guterres, to stop building new coal power plants, because around the world there is a movement of closing coal power plants, particularly in Europe, but not all over the world. And in addition, there are some countries, particularly in Asia, where China or India, they are planning to build new coal power plants. So today we want to bring you here the experience of some countries in Europe, and also we have a person from Chile that you don't know English. Okay, tú puedes hablar en español sin problema. Vamos a hacerlo en Spanish para que todo el mundo pueda seguir. And from Chile, given that this year the COP is the president is under Chile. So we wanted to bring someone from Chile to tell us the experience of coal fire plants. And I have with me distinguished panelists today. One is my colleague from IDMA, Carlota Ruiz Bautista, who is a lawyer, and we have been working a lot on coal phase out in Spain, and she will explain our experience. Then I have with me as well Alexandru Mustata, who works for Bankwatch in Romania. And in Romania there is a really very important experience that you will let us know. And finally, we have Gonzalo Saez de Miera from Iberdrola. He will tell us the experience of Iberdrola on the closure of coal fire plants here in Spain and around the world, and all its capacity, what they have been doing. And finally, Cata Alonso Raggio, who is una mujer luchadora en Chile que trabaja y vive en una de las denominadas zonas de sacrificio. Cata nos va a comentar qué es una zona de sacrificio y cuál es la situación de las centrales de carbón en Chile. So I think I'm going to give the floor first to Alexander. I would like to ask you what is the situation in your country regarding coal power plants and mines as well, and whether you think that there are some possibilities to have a coal phase out in 2030.
Buenas tardes. Thank you very much, Isma, for the invitation. I'm going to speak maybe not only about Romania, but also about some countries nearby, because I think... Yeah, is it better? Like, okay. Not only Romania, but maybe some countries nearby Romania as well, because I think we are the troubled child of the European Union. So we have few countries who did not commit to the phase-out by 2030, apart from Romania. There is Bulgaria, there is Poland, there is Czech Republic, and in these countries I think situations are quite similar. The level of development is a bit below the EU average, in some cases much more below than the EU average, in some other cases they close the gap since 1990 quite a lot. And the reliance on similar as well. In the Czech Republic, you have a production of coal which is about 50% of production, same is for Romania. In Romania, it's less than that, it's about 30%. Now, I think that it would be easier for Romania and Czech Republic to phase out coal by 2030. I think it would be very possible for these countries to do it various reasons. I mean, in the Czech Republic, they have a big production of coal, it's half of their production right now, but they are exporting a lot to Germany. So they cannot shift, they can shift their economy not to rely so much on coal production and really to plan a transition of that sector. In Romania, we have a situation that we have a very diversified energy mix. We have literally everything you can imagine. We have nuclear gas, we have a lot of hydro. Hydro is actually the biggest source of electricity in the country, but everything is very balanced. And since about 7 years ago, we also have renewables. Now we have a good production of electricity from wind and solar resources, but this is still a lot below our potential. If you look at the potential for solar energy, of course, Spain is by far the champion of Europe. Then you have Greece, and then actually in Romania and Bulgaria, there are some areas which have an amazing potential. They're right below Greece and Spain in terms of potential. When it comes to wind power as well, we have this capacity to develop more. We have the biggest wind power park in Southeast Europe in Romania. There's some good potential in Bulgaria as well. And I think these are fields which can be, in which you can go in order to phase out the coal by 2030. Of course, the big problem why this is not happening in these countries is down to politics. The governments do not have strategies in place to phase out coal, and they do not plan to do this actually. The policy is very officially pro-coal. And I think this is a challenge that we need to overcome. The countries need to understand the contribution of coal to the climate crisis, and they need to take concrete steps in order to phase out this fossil fuel. Of course, it varies from country to country. The reasons I can speak about Romania, it's really there was a big decrease of employment in hard coal, for example. It was 50,000 employees in 1990. Today, it's 4,000. And the region really needs a just transition for the remaining 4,000, but for their communities as well. Because, all right, we can find solutions for the workers maybe, because the numbers of employees are not so high anymore, but what happens to the communities? What happens if those people, most of them, go into early retirement, because the average age of workers actually is close to retirement, so they could all go into early retirement by 2030. The average age in lignite in Romania, for example, it's 48 years old. So that would be possible if you have a plan over 10 years or 11 years. The problem, of course, is that you cannot have a region with everybody doing it. You need to find some. I think this is something that the country needs to plan in parallel with the coal phase. I will stop now and maybe I will go back.
Thank you, Alexandru. So, ahora cedo la palabra a Catalonso para que nos comente su experiencia vivir en una zona de sacrificio que supone y cuáles las posibilidades y qué acciones se están haciendo por parte de la sociedad civil en Chile, pero también por el gobierno de Chile y si cree que hay alguna posibilidad de que se logre un cierre de las centrales en Chile para el año 2030, como ha pedido el Parlamento chileno.
Zona de sacrificio, vivo ahí. ¿Ustedes dirán qué es una zona de sacrificio? Bueno, una zona de sacrificio es cuando tiene contaminado el agua dulce, el mar, el aire y la tierra, todo. Nosotros tenemos 19 presas en un radio de 8 kilómetros y en que tenemos dos localidades, Quintero y Puchuncaví, peligrosa y contaminante, emitiendo tóxicos en forma simultánea. Entre ellas tenemos una fundición de cobre y cuatro termoeléctricas. En casi ninguna parte del mundo se ponen termoeléctricas al lado de fundiciones porque las energías producen cáncer. Uno de cuatro de nuestros niños en Puchuncaví están así iniciando con diferentes tipos de problemas, desde malformaciones congénitas, que es lo más grave, hasta CI bajo, que hay muchísimo, que eso es lo más suave. Esto nos ha traído a nosotros muy malas consecuencias. Partimos hace 40 años con una termoeléctrica carbón. En este minuto hay 4 termoeléctricas de carbón de SGNL. Las consecuencias han sido gravísimas. Este año llevamos 170